working in several regions to bring together
young people in the youth arm of the People's Progressive Party. So far, we have completed about half of the regions, and the work will be ongoing to ensure that we also have our youth conferences and youth camps in regions 10, 7, 3, 6, and part of 8, because these have not been done as yet. But from those youth camps and youth conferences we've completed, we had over 6,000 young people attending, many of whom have now formally become part of the youth arm of the party. I think this is an enormous number of young people. I do not think that there is any youth organization that has those numbers anywhere in our country. And as you heard in the interactive sessions at the youth camps and the youth conferences, young people speaking freely about their expectations and how they believe they can contribute to the development of our party and the country. If you look at the images coming out of these youth conferences, you will see the true nature of the People's Progressive Party and the youth movement that we are forming. It's a multi-ethnic gathering of young people. So on several counts, we're unmatched. First of all, in terms of sheer numbers of young people coming together. Secondly, in terms of its broad-based membership. As we always say, that the People's Progressive Party is the only multi-ethnic party in this country, and that's mirrored in the youth movement too. If you look at the other political forces that are contending against us, it's parties that can't even put together numbers across the board, much less among young people. They have some small gatherings that they magnify through social media, but really, when you look at sheer numbers, they come nowhere near what the PPP has accomplished. And the reason we are attractive to young people is because we're a party that has a long history of fighting for freedom in this country, from independence to the return of democracy to Guyana, and then fighting off again the PNC's attempt to steal, PNC-AFC attempt to steal the 2020 elections. We have a long track record of accomplishments moving Guyana forward. We have a track record of giving young people opportunities at various levels, but even at the highest levels in the country, at the ministerial level, at the presidential level. As I pointed out in the past, and I tell young people, I grew up in the PYO, in the youth arm of the party, and in my 20s, I was minister, and by 35, president. Irfan Ali was a member of the youth arm of the party. He became a minister in his 20s, and by age 40, he became the president of the country. So the youth arm of the party is an incubator for our leadership. And if you look at most of our leaders, they've come out of the youth arm of the party. They get a ground in there, they learn empathy with people, they learn about struggles, and that's the message that we've been speaking about at these youth camps, that it's not just about personal development, and we push our people to grow personally, those who join us at the youth level, but it's also about developing a social consciousness and about empathy with struggling people. Because if you can empathize with struggling people, then you'd become good leaders, and you will find that people's concerns would always be reflected in governance and in policy making. And that's the message we've been talking about at all of these camps, apart from the opportunity for young people to get together and socialize. So for us, the rebuilding of our youth movement is a crucial part for the continuity of our party, for the growth of our party, and placing it in secure hands. We are still dealing with fossils in the other parties. And if you can see the age range, the AFC now, the new leadership, that they've tried to portray as new leaders who have been tainted in the past, Nigel Hughes, Pat Patterson, Trotman, they're all are leaders from the past who have failed on every count. They've broken every promise they made in the past to the electorate. They've demonstrated they had no integrity whatsoever, but they have now reimaged themselves as the new leaders for the future. But they're all around my age. Ramjetan and all of the others are probably even older than me, some of them. And the same thing with the PNC. It's an old cabal of leaders. So in this you will see itself, what we are doing. We are planning for the future. We are planning to change the guard at some point in time, because we constantly do that. If you look at the attrition at the level of the cabinet and the attrition at the level of the leadership of the party in the central committee of the party, you will see that in the new central committee of the party, we have had 25% of the composition of the party are made up of people who are new. Many are young leaders. You've seen that. That is at the highest level of the party. Young leaders like Sarah Brown and Brenton Lashley and a whole range, Charles Ramson, come in, and that group of people around that age. And they're in their 30s. And even at the government level, the crop of ministers in this government changed from the last government in 2015. We had a lot of young people come in, and I expect that in the future, from the young PYO now, those who are trained and exposed, etc., the new crop of leaders will emerge at the national level. So we are looking to the future. That's how our party works. And young people have a great future in this party because they're given opportunities. It's not that APNU did not have young people. In 2015, they had a whole slew of young people who were misled and were leading the campaign. And then they discovered the true nature of the PNC and AFC as soon as they got into office. A corrupt cabal of leaders had nothing to do with the same people who campaigned for them, gave no opportunity to young people. I think the average age of the cabinet was near 60, and under APNU, and that was how it was. So I'm very pleased with the great turnout that we have had, and the eagerness of young people to associate with the PPP. And this is something that needs to be hopefully replicated by other parties. We've had, as I said before, over 6,000 young people come out. That's more than the votes of maybe five or six of the political parties that contested the last elections. And you're gonna see more of them come out now in different form, but I'll talk about that in later. So I'm pleased that the party is growing in among young people. There are quite a few things that sometimes in the big rush to every day to complete tasks and to move our country forward and to address the overload on the policy agenda that we've had. Because if you look at every sector of the economy and the time frame that we've been in government and how far we've advanced the policy agenda in each sector of the economy, you'll be amazed at the amount of work that was done, is being done, and that goes unreported. And in every sector. And sometimes we do not spend enough time in a detailed way talking about these issues. So, for example, on digitization of the country and how that will be crucial for the future, I have not seen a serious article written about that anywhere for the last maybe year and a half, maybe 2 years, maybe I missed it. But I doubt that anything of that nature was written about. Every day you see the same old story surfacing in different fashion. It's almost repetitive. But this is crucial to changing Guyana and to the lives of our people. Digitization of our society. And many people, if they're not aware, should be aware that we have several projects that are moving us closer to the accomplishment of key tasks in our country that would allow people to have a greater level of comfort, security, and would expand business opportunities because of the digitization strategy of the government. So the first thing is we have a project that you know of, you might have heard of, that will make our airport paperless. And we are hoping by the end of the year that this will happen, that we have an automated border management system that will pre-screen people, that would allow us to know long before people have arrived in the country who they are and their background. And this would allow us to have these automated gates so that with the new ID that we will be issuing soon, or a passport, you'll be able to just swipe your ID or your passport without approaching an immigration officer and enter the country. But if you're flagged by the border management system, then you'd have to, of course, approach an immigration officer. That would allow people to online or through an app fill up all of the entry forms, as their customs declaration, so everything is online, and that will be shared directly to the GRA immediately. So if you declare you're bringing in $10,000 in the country, goes immediately almost to the GRA, or you're taking $10,000 out the country. So they get that information, you know, that, and so when you enter in the country, immediately that record goes to a government central database that will be able to track you if you come in on a short-term visa. So you can't, if you overstay, suddenly you get flagged. And if you don't have a work, you didn't come in on a particular visa, you can't get a work permit. So a modern system to manage the safety of our country and our borders, that we can know who's coming into our country and we can keep our people secure, and that we can flag undesirables before they come home. And this system will make it easy for those Guyanese now who have their own, our own ID. We can swipe and walk into the country easily, and you'd also have automated gates going out. So that it makes the ease of travel for everyone easier to travel, but more, even easier for the locals, that those of us who have Guyanese passport or citizenship. That is happening now. Simultaneously, we have the project to issue the new ID cards for every Guyanese, but and for everyone else who lives in the country, with strong biometrics features. Now, we decided not to touch the GCOM ID, because you would have heard APNU say that we want to control the issuance of that ID. Their GCOM can continue to issue its ID, but this ID will have some of the strongest security features in the world. It would have modern chip, and it would allow one, the Guyanese will have a different color ID than foreigners. So, but everyone would be required to have one of these IDs, because without the ID, you would not be able to open a bank account or access, say, some government services, not healthcare or anything like that, but some types of government services. So we will know who is in our country too, because every non-citizen would have to have an ID too. And that would allow us to track people who are here illegally, etc. This is crucial as we grow as a country, but would also allow our people with this ID now to enjoy significant benefits that others may not enjoy. So if we, for example, if we have to give out, say grants to people, cash grants, etc., we know who the Guyanese are immediately because they have an ID with all of the biometrics. This would allow, with strong biometrics, would allow a whole range of financial products offered by the banking system now that requires high-level security. And therefore, greater access around the country through things like online banking and electronic transfer of money, maybe using even phones, etc., make that widespread and cheaper, so that people who live even in remote areas can have access to banking functions without even having a bank in their villages. If you live in the hinterland areas or in riverine areas that don't have any banks. So this will make a huge difference, because it's not just the ID, but what happens with that level of biometrics. It would also, you know, there is a third project we have, it's called a Safe Guyana project, that where we have now the first phase, we're working from, there is a monitoring center now with the high resolution smart cameras in Region 4. Those have now been deployed to Region 3 and 6, the most populous regions outside of 4. We have the monitoring centers there, so they can track any situation where you have criminal activities. They can monitor this 24 hours a day, these cameras. That would give us valuable intelligence and allow us to intercept criminals should we need to do that. If you have, these cameras are capable of running predictive software so that you can almost anticipate high crime areas and deploy security to them. We're expanding this around the country. These would be able to electronically track vehicles, to assist with giving, say, e-tickets without even having to a policeman to stop someone for speeding. They would, if they're speeding, they will just get an e-ticket and then they would have to pay the fine or comply with the law, it gets sent to them. That is going on. People don't write about this, but it's happening. There's a fourth project that is automating all the functions of the Ministry of Home Affairs. So now all of these databases would be linked. Births, deaths, marriage records, criminal databases that we have, fingerprints. So if we, for example, a camera has facial recognition software on it, and we have now the biometrics of everyone in a database, you can find people easily and in the country if there is any, or they could be recognized easily if there is any criminal activity. But what we have done is that we have strengthened the privacy laws too, because we don't want this to be abused by law enforcement, where people, you know, go and visit somebody and then suddenly they get tracked, etc., for other purposes. So that we don't want a police society. So you can go to jail for giving out that sort of information. And the same thing on another project now, the fifth project, is one with the electronic patient record system. So again, once you have a record in the system, even in the public hospital, you would be able to take that to a private hospital should you go there, the doctors from the private hospital. So if you do an x-ray, your entire history will be here. So when a patient goes to see a doctor, the doctor sits at the computer, they just put in the ID and the name, and they will see the entire patient's history, x-rays, high blood pressure reading, everything, so they can better administer to the patient. You often have doctors go in there, people can't find their old records, they don't know where it is. If they go to the private hospital, or they were going to private hospital and they go to the public hospital, you don't have any records of them there. So all of that will change, but then there will be severe penalties too for sharing people's records. Severe penalties for doing that, because you don't want people's medical history to be in the public domain or release. And so that also would help us to better administer healthcare. These are only five elements that are ongoing now that people sometimes pay no attention to, because it's not fashionable to talk about these things. But it requires a lot of policy time, and a lot of decisions had to be made, and a lot of work is taking place to modernize our society, to mirror the physical changes that we are seeing in Guyana. These are the infrastructure changes in a modern world. We've also committed ourselves to use blockchain technology in two areas, particularly the land records in this country, and also in GGMC, the mine records. Because we have had complaints about people in those places, leases are given out or prospecting licenses on a first-come, first-served basis. So if someone can alter the records of anyone, so say if you apply in August and someone comes to apply for the same piece of land in September, I'm supposed to get it because I applied in August. Now, the person, if they can disappear my record, then the person in September might get it. And we've had complaints that sometimes records are tampered with, so that people who, like if someone finds a bit of gold on the land, suddenly there is a claim that two other persons were on there, had made applications before that person. We have had cases where mines officer falsified information. With blockchain technology, which is the basis on which bitcoins are issued, you cannot go back to alter any record. Cannot do that. It will be impossible to alter previous records. So we are looking at projects to now start looking at blockchain technology in those areas, particularly where records could be tampered with. There are other government agencies we probably introduce that to. So I wanted, because every week it's the same old issue I have to talk about all the time. But I wanted people to understand the nature of the work. They see a lot of physical transformation in Guyana. More roads, more schools, more hospitals being built. They see the expansion, more people working now, job creation. They see more people on scholarships. Those are things that you can measure. But often there is a hidden engine that is going on all the time and working that you don't ever get, would never get reported on, because somehow it's not very attractive to people, or it doesn't fit in to the political agenda of those who are in the media often. I'll return to some of these things in greater details, because what I told you there is just like the tip of the iceberg. And as I said before, not just in this one area, but almost in every sector, there is a story to tell of how policy-wise we are changing almost everything. You hear a lot of talk about environment, but we don't see much written about the LCDS, which is the biggest success story for any country in the developing world, even in the developed world. The biggest success story for any country. And that's recognized as such in Guyana. In Little Guyana, we have done that. We have changed it all. But that doesn't get recorded. But it didn't happen by itself. It required serious policy initiatives and leadership and also hard work. Hard work. So the debate in our society does not take place around serious issues about the low carbon development strategy and the opportunity to earn more resources and how it's solving questions of adaptation and giving a big boost to indigenous development. You don't hear the debates surrounding that. You don't hear debates about digitization of our society or what the plans are, the serious plans are to address healthcare at multiple levels, infrastructure, management, personnel, and supplies, so that all of these things, how they're being addressed. You don't hear much debate around that. You don't hear about our master plan for making education more accessible, raising the quality of it, and reducing the cost. You hear about pit latrines. That's all that dominates the debate. So, as I said before, our opponents will never want to take the conversation to serious issues because they know they have no track record or no policy. I see the new policy is that they talk about put out some little bits of paper and, oh, we will do better than the PPP. They will do better than us. Well, you can't believe anything. So the part-time workers that they were opposed to, Norton was opposed to the part-time workers, the PNC was opposed to them, AFC was opposed to the part-time workers, the 15,000. They're saying, we don't need this in the system. Now they're saying, oh, we'll pay you a bit more. We'll keep you and pay you a bit more. But they lack creativity. They lack creativity. So you will see the incremental thing. Oh, we'll pay the public servants a bit more, but and we do it from saving some money somewhere. And we'll talk a little bit about that, which is nonsense itself. But you can't believe anything they say because they have a track record of not fulfilling, lying to the people of this country. So we have to keep the conversation at the serious level. We'd have to keep the conversation there all the time. This is where they run from. The Nigel Hughes will go and find a couple of kids maybe under a tree because we're building the nursery school now, rebuilding a nursery school and say, look at these kids now studying under school. But then in the same breath complains about the $2 billion school that we're building at Hosororo. In the same breath complains about that. It's a bunch of wishy-washy people looking has-beens, basically, like Nigel Hughes. Nothing new to offer, going around trying to stir up resentment or create this disaffection with the government by rumors. But it's not resonating, as you can see, because the people in those, the same places that they visit, know the experience is different. And they came out of a recent pass too from APNU, a recent pass that they remember very well, particularly the Amerindians. They have a very, very disparaging view of Amerindians. They think that they probably have amnesia over what took place in the 5 years. They think that these communities have just forgotten everything. It may happen in some coastal villages, but trust me, it's not happening in those areas because I talk to people who have seen their lives destroyed, disrupted by APNU with a deliberate campaign to destroy Amerindians. And they did it through the land policy and the vile position that they had on land policy that the same AFC and APNU, the PNC, sat in parliament and heard the most disparaging statements being made by the PNC, by an individual. They did it through everything. The resources in those communities were minimal. They were starved of resources. Starved of resources. So, talking about distortion. So first of all, you're going to hear me every week remind you about the weighty issues, the things that matter to people, not the frivolous issues that they're wallowing in. Because every week, that's all. You hear somebody, a tree didn't get cut here, somebody didn't smile too nicely with one of them and they're offended with this, etc. They want to run from the serious issues of running a government because they have no management skill or track record of doing so properly. So they would hide from that and try to focus on this. So I'll remind them and the country of what we are doing and how in these 4 years we have had a transformative agenda in every sector, including the oil and gas sector, that we can defend publicly. And then I will point out the ridiculous things that they're doing now to rewrite history. I will do this every week, and they hate this badly. So, talking about that and how stupid we could get sometimes in this country is that I saw this week the leader of the opposition office issued a statement on the International Day of Democracy and talking about we must fight for democracy. And then the AFC also did the same thing. And a long statement on International Day of Democracy. And in this statement, they spoke about extrajudicial killing, the AFC, the old thing about 1,500 people being killed in that period, which is a lie. In fact, they were saying it's 400. Starbuck News showed that. And the 400, if you go back and look at it, even the 400 were not bandits. They included the policemen who were killed in that period, etc. And even people who are alive, and they were not Afro-Guyanese alone. There are large numbers of Indo-Guyanese in the 400. They've elevated the number now to 1,500. It used to be 40. One time, Walter Lawrence said 40,000, right? So these are the stupidest people in the world. I don't imagine. If you pick a number, you have to at least stick with the number. If you pick a number to tell a lie, they need to, you know, repeat the same number over and over again. So the 400 was disproved. Now it had gone to 1,500. It was 40,000. They can't settle on the number, but it's all a lie. So Granger had promised to have a commission of inquiry into this, the killings at that time, the troubled period. And the troubled period was when the PNC and AFC supported a group of bandits who escaped from the prison and wreak havoc on ordinary citizens in this country until they were either arrested or killed by their security forces. They were upfront supporting these people, politically on television, calling them freedom fighters, etc. People who are killing babies and everyone else. That's the role of the PNC. And they have the audacity to talk about extrajudicial killing, the AFC now. And it was in the same period that they say Nigel Hughes removed the tape from the gas station, tampered with police evidence, the Hamilton gas station. Tampered with evidence. Nigel Hughes was in part of this. He removed that. He gave some wishy-washy explanation. Read the Starbuck News story about it, about why he removed the tape, that the police would have seen who actually killed the person. Took the tape and then returned it the next day, I think. We don't know what happened with the tape, whether it was edited or tampered with. So someone should ask him about that too. And they put this in now, this week, in a statement to talk about extrajudicial killing and the period. Because they have nothing new. They're trying to race back the old race thing. And notice it's 1,500 young black men that we killed. The racist issue again, to bring back the old rumors that they spread, which has been disproved over and over again, but they continue to perpetrate their lies. So, since why do you think Granger never launched the Commission of Inquiry? Granger was notorious for launching commissions of inquiry. He did about 8 of them and spent nearly $500 million on commissions of inquiry. Lindo Creek, he did one for Gaisuko, he did for the prison break, he did one for the public service, a ton of COI. And he promised this in the election, before the election. Why do you think he did not do this one? He was dissuaded, I think, from doing it because he knew what would have showed up. And the culpable party would have been APNU. I spoke with some elements from the U.S. law enforcement agency that came down and met with me when I was president there. And they said to me, you're not dealing with a situation of criminality here. You're dealing with an insurgency there because the APNU, the AFC and PNC operatives and at that time, and I think some of the individuals who were in the AFC now were part of the PNC at that time. So they were going on the ground, talking to the criminals, supplying them with stuff, also telling people in the villages, a group of people, that every time the law enforcement agencies went in there, that they must come out in front of the police and the soldiers. In that period, guess who I had? So we had weapons laws. As president, had to deal with Winston Felix as commissioner of police, and Collins, both of whom went out, joined the PNC and became members of the leadership of that party. I think they both got into the central executive of the party. That is what I had to deal with. A commissioner and a chief of the army who might have been even sabotaging me as president. And so clearly it came up at the human rights body when we went there, which is every 10 years or 15 years you have to present there. It came up about when we're gonna do this, and the terms of reference are being drafted, and soon the president will announce the COI. So we'll get to the bottom of this. We'll get to the bottom of this. But the shameless AFC talks about extrajudicial killing in that period. And if you look at who defended all of the people who massacred some of these people, Nigel Hughes was there. I think even the case where, please check this for me, if you have that, check where in the Starbuck News again, that Nigel Hughes was accused of jury tampering because the foreman of the jury was one of his clients and he was supposed to declare this if there was any connection. And they failed to do so. And I think the person was acquitted, one of the murderers. So check it out for me yourselves. Go back and Google that. And so who was on the side of the criminals? And they mentioned this in a statement on United Nations International Day of Democracy this week. So they brought it right back to the fore. In the same statement, they mention Integrity Commission. The Integrity Commission is another prime example of a weak state body. This is the AFC APNU that refused to submit their statement of income and asset to the Integrity Commission for 3 years in the 5 years they were in office. And from the year we've submitted ours. And they talk, they have the shamelessness. These are shameless people in the AFC and in the PNC too, but more so the AFC, to put that in a statement now, this week, on the International Day of Democracy. They talk about the weak EPA. Well, the weakest EPA we had was when they took a party act and put him to head the EPA, which is Vincent Adams. They took a party hack who was on the platform with them and put him to head the EPA, and he signed the weakest agreement that we've had, the environmental permit that we've had with Exxon. But they're democratic. So these two groups should be, so forget all that I said. Forget everything that I said. But the ultimate low-life behavior, the ultimate shamelessness is for them to say anything about democracy. The PNC has every elections in our history either stolen those elections or sought to steal the elections. Every election in our history. And they succeeded in 3 decades to keep, they succeeded in 3 decades. And that's well documented, indisputable, that they stole elections to stay in office. And then it's also well documented that they tried to steal the 2020 elections again. It's indisputable. For them to talk about, to even issue a statement on the International Day of Democracy, it's unbelievable. It's like, you know, people go to church and the priest has to constantly hold his chain because he's worried that they would snatch his chain or something like that. That's these people. They can't say anything. Look at the lies that they told. You remember Kathy Yu saying, and Ramjetan, how they found Russians and everybody here, Granger trying to be sworn in 3-4 times. Look at the trauma that they put the country through. 5 months of trying to steal the elections. International sanctions being threatened. CARICOM issuing statement. OAS, the Commonwealth, the Carter Center. Every country in the world practically condemning it. And up to now, Norton, he has his SOPs. He's like Maduro. They have their statements of poll, but they can't make them public. In Maduro's case, somebody hacked their system. He said that somebody hacked their system. So in Norton's case, they are state secret up to now. The SOPs that show that they won the elections, that they should have been happy to make public. So imagine 2 shameless parties trying to rewrite the history of this country and to get us to forget the sick, sordid, unpatriotic, vile role that they played in trying to steal the elections. And the AFC leaders were in the thick of things. And I don't think anybody has asked Nigel Hughes again whether he thought that the elections in 2020, that they won the elections in 2020, a free and fair way. So we need to look at that. So in the same week, we have had another development. So the Kaichou News, the Glen Lal, has now launched a political party. So sometimes I try to talk seriously about this gentleman. But like every time I do, I can't get past a few thoughts. So it's like the things that come straight into my head that flash across my brain are like circus, Bozo the Clown, lunacy, idiocy. Now, I can understand political parties trying to win support among people. PNC is trying to use race. AFC is notorious for lying. But this guy, he can't string two coherent thoughts together. And so he has to, his target group would be the idiots of this country. You have to be, that's where I'm stuck. I'm stuck really. It's hard to criticize this circus. But this is a free country and a free society. And so anybody can contest elections. We have had to deal with lots of parties similar to this one. We had CN Sharma in the past. For those of you who remember him, we've had CN Sharma. We've had 5 or 6 small parties contest the last elections. And people saw through, most of them, that they had nothing to offer the people of this country except their ego, and that their wealth lie their way into office if they could. And so here again, we have another attempt to do so, and we will deal with it at the appropriate time. Because it is open season now, and people see an opportunity. So I've seen, again, outside of Bozo the Clown, the Starbuck News has a strange newspaper, a story. I thought it was an ad, but this looks like a movie that we are going to, you know, coming to the theater soon. So guard, coming soon, stay tuned. Now this is a news story, I don't think it's an ad. So I can't believe that a newspaper would put guard, Ghana United for Accountability and Resource Development, coming soon, stay tuned. This is like a movie soon to come. And a new group is to be launched next year, so they know who the new group are. So if there are credible names behind the group, observers say it would make an interesting year in 2025. And the 10 to 12% Amerindian vote and the independent and floating vote are seen to be available to new parties to prospect for. So this is like you're prospecting, you're going to mine for these people's votes. Now, GARD was, and I wonder if they're stuck in the past again. GARD used to be an organization, for those of you who don't know, when there was a fight for free and fair elections in Guyana. In 1992, in the period running up to 1992, after 28 years in office without elections, after the elections were supposed to be held in 1990, and they were postponed because the voters list was unacceptable. And after President Carter came here, when also President Bush Sr. got involved, where and the PPP was pushing, leading the struggle at that time, GARD came up to support that struggle for free and fair elections. So it's an old organization. So it was one that was, it was to fight for free and fair elections. So clearly, I'm thinking now, for the past several weeks, there've been an attempt to paint Guyana and the PPP as autocratic. I didn't deal with it too much from people like Ramcharan and the others. All these book reviews that they're doing, selective book reviews, like Maurice Odle, a man who was at NISIL from 2015 to 2020. The head of NISIL, at that time, some of the most corrupt acts in the country took place under the aegis of NISIL. Suddenly they're doing a big review. He is an impartial person on governance now in Guyana. And then the review of another right-wing writer from abroad, but both leading to the conclusion that the PPP is somehow autocratic. So that might have been an organization like GARD will emerge now. But it is, they have to be creative now. If you choose the old name, it's like recycle people. And I'm sure you'd find a ton of recycle people here. Recycle people who are never comfortable with ordinary people having a say in policy making. Forget the sugar workers, so every day you have editorials, oh, the sugar workers don't deserve this. Forget the Amerindians. Forget the people in Region 10, the bauxite workers or Afro-Guyanese in the villages. Forget everybody, mixed people and everyone else, or forget young people. We don't need to deal with that. We need a bunch of fossils in the city who believe that they know best for Guyana, who will reside abroad and everything must be cleared with them. It's the arrogance there. It's the arrogance that is coming soon. The new movie, A Dictator Nearest to You. This is how they see the politics in Guyana. Not that they needed to work over the years, 4 years, and the last year before election, opportunistically they done already surface to care about Guyana, but they care about the resources. And I want to bet you half of these fossils are people who have come to the government because they want cushy jobs, and I know some of them already who wanted cushy jobs, or us to force out other professionals from the APNU era, and they claim that they are close to the PPP, and we refuse to do so, they now suddenly become fighters for good governance, natural resources they want to guard. They didn't guard the natural resources when Trotman in 2016 signed the worst agreement that we have to live with now. They couldn't guard it at that time. They didn't find a proper guard at that time because half of them, you would see, probably were in bed with APNU. So coming to Guyana soon, it's the circus season. Circus season. And Glenn Lal, the Bozo the Clown, is starring over there with, and then you have another group who'd coming to the theaters nearest to you soon that will emerge. But I want to bet you they're not going to go after APNU or AFC. They know why too, they're scared. I've seen cowards who would never say anything about APNU because they're worried about being bullied. But who would find their voices on the PPP? But it's a free country, it's a free society, and we can all contest the elections. But let me tell you something about the PPP. When we contested in 2020, APNU was in office. APNU hired nearly 14,000 people after the no confidence motion. APNU spent $419.5 billion from the no confidence motion to the date of the elections, the period in the elections. They had control of the police, the army. They had control over all the state media. They used to bully people. They harassed their political opponents. They planted special branch in my office as leader of the opposition. We had them. We then had several small parties, the other parties to contest against. And we won the elections. We won the elections. So everything was aligned against us because people recognize that the PPP will work for them. You think now, with the APNU diminishing, people see them now, they have a leadership problem, not only leadership problem, but they have an accountability problem there. They're just all over. I don't know if they want to come together for the elections, how they can do so, because Roysdale Ford has said, implied that this Norton is racially oriented. They have said that he is unaccountable. They accuse him of, I don't know if it's attempted rape, but molestation of one of their female activists. This is all open from that party. So how will they get together on the basis of what? They don't have any program too over there to help people. What are they going to come together about again? It would be just a convenience thing because of the lower of power. So they are deeply divided. And then the AFC trying to rework itself now is just a shadow of its former self. A shadow of its former self with this group of fossil leaders, total leadership of fossil, probably as ancient as anyhow, anything that you would, the oldest rock in Guyana, they're trying to present themselves as new. So they're not in the position anymore to do the things that they were doing. On the other hand, we've been working hard in communities. You've seen that. We have made what I said in opposition, that we'd expand the PPP. We have done that. We are trying to expand the PPP in different parts of the country, among different races, because we had Afro-Guyanese underrepresented in the party. It's the only party that has acknowledged that and trying to work to change it. We have come out of local government elections with stronger standing in New Amsterdam, in Georgetown, in Bartica. In fact, we won Bartica, we won Madia, in Mabaruma, almost every area. Mabaruma, in Kwakwani, we came out with stronger standing there, our overall votes. So we're in a better position than in 2020. So we're not worried or afraid of these people. They're going to go back to the same lies. It's about, oh, PPP corrupt. They did that well in 2020. So listen to the Gulsaran now. Gulsaran weighs into another fossil. He tries to present himself as a person of high integrity. And so he sued me because I said he lacks integrity. And the case is coming up. And in my pleadings, I said, he's the one who talks about the Procurement Act and violation of the Procurement Act. And in 2015, he took a contract from the government that did not go to tender. The same Jordan, who was minister that he's praising up in this article now, gave him a contract that he didn't tender for. And secondly, the contract was illegally given to him because the law, the audit act says only two entities can approve contracts, audit contracts. It's the Auditor General or the Public Accounts Committee of the National Assembly, not the minister. That's the Audit Act that he policed over the years as Auditor General. He knows it fully well. He took a contract that did not have the approval of the Auditor General nor the Public Accounts Committee, given to him by the minister. And guess what he said in a letter? That he did not tender. This is his explanation. Read it. He said, I got a call from the minister, and the minister said to me, which one of these contracts you want? And he picked a few of them, and then he got another call. You have the contract. Just imagine if the PPP were to do something like that. They're murderous. They're murderous. You wouldn't hear the last of it for 100 years. This is this man saying how he got a contract from the... So I have no doubt that he will praise Jordan. He said, oh, the minister said they can save 10% of money, Jordan. Another man who is in court for unaccountable behavior. I don't even want to go down there. You know his history too, and the role he played in... We still have not explored that fully in the corruption that was at the Guy Oil and the Army, $1 billion corrupt act there by some individuals in the Guy Oil and the Army. So, and I think that's going to go to court, or it's before somebody has been charged with that. So, he has come down now to 10%. This is the same man who said in 2015 you could save 50 billion because contracts were per year from award of contracts, 45%. And when asked to tell us how you would save 1 billion from which project, couldn't give an answer. But he comes out every week in the Starbuck News is talking about accountability. Pure nonsense. So he supports this week. And he says, oh, he was so great because Desmond Hoyt was the chairman of some MMA board, and Desmond Hoyt wouldn't tolerate corruption, so he was clean and above the board. Look at what he just said. Look at what he said. So they would have all of these fossils, roll them out to support the false narrative because he was a beneficiary of the corruption because he would call that corruption. He would call the giving a minister calling you and giving you a contract corruption. But he was a beneficiary of the same corruption then. If that was corruption, he's the beneficiary of it. So they will roll all of them out. And I have no doubt he might be one of the new guard, the old guard, the guard or whatever, coming soon. He might be one of them too. So let's go on. So a complete rewrite of democracy and who stood in the fight against the attempt to steal the elections. You remember they tried to even bully the people who put up the cameras. Remember Gifland, the guy from Gifland. The cameras to watch the containers by the convention center. Remember Valdo Lawrence saying, oh, COVID, you can't go in there, you can't do the recount, using COVID as the excuse. Remember, they didn't give the Carter Center approval to come back. All of this, that they used to come out every day and lie to the people. Oh, I think we have to just replay some of those tapes from that period to remind people, because if they're not reminded, then they will take seriously, or they may take seriously, the stupid statements that these people issue on democracy. They wouldn't even recognize democracy even if it bites them in the ass. It's like this all the time. They would not recognize it. And so Jordan now comes out to, again, Jordan wants people to pay the tolls. He said people can fly to New York and pay tolls, so we must charge them the tolls because it hurts them that the president announced. And we deliberately thought about this, and we said we will make all the bridges that are being built in Wismar and across the river to Region 3 and the one in Burbies, all of them toll-free. Concrete structures, four-lane, high structures, and in these two, and they would all three of them will be toll-free. And we stand by that position. APNU could put back the tolls if they want. But of course, they may not have a chance to do that, because I don't see them ever getting back into office. Like you did not have, like last week I said, you didn't have any VAT on water, electricity, data, etc. But Jordan put them on machinery and equipment. And so he also said, oh, we put the toll on education, the VAT on education, and then we remove it back. But why did the government remove the corporate tax from education? You know why, Jordan? So that we can have an expansion. It supports your policy making, has to support your objective. If we say that we want world-class education in our country, you have to support the institutions that deliver this. As a result of this, we're seeing more investments in education. People have to, there is no upward pressure, a significant upward pressure on private fees because we've removed the corporate tax. And we've seen, so not just local investments, but foreign investments. We have a number of foreign universities that want to come here, create jobs for people, etc. I can't imagine how someone would think this way. We remove it, we put it in our manifesto, the removal of corporate tax from education and healthcare, and we did so. This guy, in 2024, he's advocating that we put back the corporate tax on education and healthcare and have tolls charged on the bridges that we announced that would be free of tolls. That's what he's advocating for. Like Jordan, like Norton said, we're subsidizing electricity prices to people, so we should remove the electricity subsidy. That meant that you would have had to pay like one third more on your electricity bill because the price was about 22 cents per kilowatt hour and it gone up to about 30, just over 30 cents per kilowatt hour. That's the cost of generation. So we shouldn't have done that. So let people pay more for their electricity bill. And on the other hand, then Jordan talks about come clean on financing of gas to energy and the debt. We've gone through this a million times on the debt. I saw someone sent me a screenshot of, I think it was someone in the Congress in the United States of America.